still doing this evening here.
Killer, man! Killer! Killer!
Hey, Gary! We love you!
Go Pavement, man!
Well, I guess we're having guitar technical difficulties.
Got some whiskey, Dick.
Whiskey, Dick, man!
Well, my name's Steve Malkmus. Some people know me as Steven, and I'm a member of Pavement.
I'd like to introduce myself. My name is Steve West, and I play drums and Pavement.
Hey, hello there, I'm Spiral Stairs, guitarist for Pavement.
I'm Mark Eibold, and I'm sitting on the back stoop of Bob Nastanovich's place in Louisville. I'm visiting here from New York, and I'm the bass player of Pavement.
My name is Bob Nastanovich. I play percussion keyboards for the rock group Pavement. I'm sitting in my backyard here in Louisville, Kentucky. And got a lot of work to do cleaning up after a long derby weekend.
Team when I was 10 years old. He was kind of the brat of the neighborhood, and I was the black sheep of the neighborhood, so kind of bonded a little bit because he used to always tease me and then I used to always beat him up.
Well, before Pavement, there was Bag of Bones. Bag of Bones was a band out of Stockton that consisted of Steven and myself. And it was kind of a New Order, Echo and the Bunnymen, REM riff-off band. And Steve was playing guitar and singing, and I played bass, and we had this other guy play drums. You know, we played like two or three shows like that, and we ended up being an instrumental band because our drummer hated the way Steve sang. So Steve was kind of coming back to Stockton for like vacations from college. He was working at this college radio station.
Hello, everyone out there. You're listening to WTJU 91.1 FM. My name is Steven.
I met him at University of Virginia in 1986, and we were both college radio DJs, and I guess realized right off the bat that we had the rare combination of being demented sports fans and college rock DJs. Steven played more like older progressive stuff, and I played like obscure current 7 inches of the day. You know, it was a great time.
So he'd come back with all these really obscure influences. And I was working at a used record store in Stockton, so, you know, I kind of had my own thing. So we'd come, kind of get together and play these records.
We tried to start a band called Ectoslavia, Make Noise. Didn't really work out.
One time when he came back, he just decided, you know, he just said, like, you know, let's just make up these songs and put out a record. You know, it's really easy to put out singles. So we found a studio in Stockton through a friend, and ended up being Gary Young, who's kind of a legendary punk rock figure in Stockton. He's this older, hippie-ish guy. So we called him up and said, yeah, Gary, you know, we want to record these songs. And he was like, yeah, come on down. I guess we went there a couple days and recorded the songs for the first single, and just kind of did the single in a couple days, recorded it one day, mixed it the next day. Obviously, it sounds like it.
And it was just like another 7-inch, and I thought, you know, with a name like Pavement, it was either sort of going to be this kind of big black thing, or, judging by the cover, it could be something even more sort of kind of nefarious, if not like completely industrial. So I was kind of intrigued. And the proprietor of the store said, like, oh yeah, that's kind of interesting, but it's somewhat unlistenable. So that sold me right away.
Steve actually heard it for the first time in Austria. I think he was in a record store, and he heard it over the record player. And he was like, wait a minute, what's that, you know? I think he told the guy at the record store, like, that's my band.
That was a song by a band called Crawl Space. While the Pavement members were retuning, and they're going to do another song for you in just a moment.
And then I got my bus driving job, and it was about that time that I'd pretty much called David and Steven constantly, and he was just in Stockton starting Pavement. Pavement had made their first 7-inch and told them that they had to be in New York. And they worked as security guards at the Whitney Art Museum, so they'd come home from work. We all lived together. And Steve West then took a job there as well. So we lived in dive apartments and went to dive bars and saw all the bands that we wanted to see. So it was a good, really good. Good time. We met Mark Eibel during that time. He was just into the same music, so we'd see him at all the shows, and he's distinct. And he was a very early Pavement fan. So when he found out that we had anything to do with Pavement and that Steven was the man behind those Pavement records, we got to be really good friends with him and found out that we had a lot in common with him.
UVA by 12.
Yes.
Yeah!
win, sucker.
So it was weird back then, like Remco, the first tour we did with Remco as our European sound man, this was in 92, like I remember him coming up to me after the end of the tour, after like 15 or 20 shows, and him saying, I do not see why you are even in this band. I don't see, you know, what the point of having you in this band is at all, you know, which really kind of hurt my feelings.
And it was kind of at a time when fanzines were like the big thing, and college radio was the big thing. You know, the hipsters of the U.S. fanzine and world kind of caught on to it and, you know, made it this cool thing. Dan from Drag City called me up one day and telling me that he wants to start a label, and he wanted us to be the first single. You know, we were like, yeah, whatever, sure.
Summer Bay. Summer Bay.
We did Slant and Enchanted. Mark and Bob kind of came into the recording side on Watery Domestic, that EP. There, you can hear them faintly talking and clapping.
Keyboard.
A little keyboard. Yeah, so.
But when I think when I joined, Slant and Enchanted tape was going around for a long time.
Right. Mm-hmm. And then we did the tour, and sort of pre-Slant and Enchanted tour. That was before it came out, and you played on it. Was that before it came out, the first mm-hmm. time you played?
How does it start?
Gigs were just sort of these kind of shambles in a way.
For that scene, it was pretty successful. I mean, just a nice review in K was like great to us, or if like the woman from K said like, your single's so great, she like wrote us a postcard, like that was a big success. Started and they haven't let up. I was just entranced with New York. I had to be on a New York label. I was living there too. And it was really handy to be able to just go right into their office, which is about as big as the sauna at the time. So yeah, we sent them the tape. We sent it all around, the Slant and Enchanted tape, you know, just thinking who's gonna like it. You know, it was just pretty exciting to see who wanted to do it. We didn't send it to any major labels or anything, but we just sort of randomly put them out, you know. All the songs on those tapes, so they were just made like tape to tape, like how you felt that day.
Excuse me.
But it created quite a commotion for the time. We were very excited for this to come out well before it came out. There were reviews and spin, you know, like 6 months before. So yeah, so, and it was actually, it took like 2 years for it to come out. So that was, in some ways that was good. That anticipation was high. So we thought it's fair to make him a full member. And then also when we did that tour out there, although he had a lot of problems with drinking and stuff, we thought he'd be all right maybe if he just pulled it together. And also we liked the sort of random element. We just didn't know what was going to happen, I think. It was sort of just a surprise element.
to eat or something, and Gary comes back with this, like, shotgun. I'm like, Gary, what's that? You know, like, you can just buy these fucking things here. You just buy a gun. We're like, oh, my God. Yeah, we had this gun, like, in our van the whole tour. You know, quite a guy, man. Amazing.
The laugh shit with him, I think we had, like, a band meeting in Denmark at the airport, and Gary said, like, I want to quit, you know, I want out.
Gary quit the band, no doubt about it. He tried to take a spin on it that he'd been fired, but he made all these irrational demands in this Copenhagen hotel room, and it was a taped band meeting. Remarkably, I was his best friend in the band, and I was his best man at his wedding, and I was the one sitting at this meeting shooting him down. You know, I was the only one that would speak up and be like, Gary, that's ridiculous. You know, and they were all just, I don't know, maybe they were stunned or upset. But he flat out at the end and was like, I quit. I absolutely quit. And we were just all, you know, Steven and Scott, I think, were sort of relieved because they didn't want to fire Gary. He'd been a huge help to him.
Well, I thought he was a fantastic drummer and, like, a nice person, too, off the stage. It just wasn't worth it, you know, to live like that.
So I just assumed at that point that I wouldn't do anything more with Pavement because, I mean, pretty much my unique role in the band was triggered by Gary. So I just assumed I'd quit.
I was living in New York at that time anyway, and I wanted people to rehearse with, and Steve had a big loft. Steve was living in New York then. He had all the drums set up and a place to practice, so it was incredibly natural.
When he decided to get the band back together again, he decided to hire on Steve West.
And it turned out to be a good choice because he's done a really good job.
I'm sure that I'd promised Gary that I will never do a Pavement show without you in the band, you know, and made a pact with him and stuff like that. And the fact that his place was being taken by a friend of mine from high school since I was 13 years old also was really heavy duty. So it was a really emotional time because I think I actually got better and became sort of more of a factor in Pavement with Steve West in the band.
I mean, to us, when people were saying Slam and Shannon was big, we were like, that's nothing. To us, that's just, we can do better, or we're gonna do better.
Little more of a change in direction, I guess, from what we had been doing in the past, which you know, we kind of had to do. We had more of a classic rock type drummer and Steve West, a much different style. But the songs were still Pavement, you know, very melodic.
Thank you. maybe the kind of success that the way what you consider success wouldn't be success to us.
And there might have also been this sort of at the start, sort of like, well, you know, fuck you, we can't play, that's cooler, you know, like, we're brats and like, you don't have to play to make good music, but you don't.
Fight this generation.
We also worked really hard for that record. You know, we toured. Bob likes to say we did 53 shows in 50 days. You know, we went all over. We did Australia, Japan, Reading, all that stuff again. You know, we worked pretty hard. That was like the first time that Pavement, like, I guess it was the first time that all of us really were able to kind of just say, okay, well, this is going to be our job, you know. Before that, it was kind of like, okay, well, you know, Mark worked as like a waiter, and Bob worked as like a bus driver, and you know, and stuff like that. And now we were like we were actually a band, and we were, you know, able to like live off the band, you know, from that record.
What's the next song?
The first show was amazing. We were so bad. It was Sinead O'Connor played before us. There was 12,000 people, I would guess, watching Sinead O'Connor, maybe 4,000 of them singing along to her songs. And I was like, you know, what in God's name is Sinead O'Connor opening for Pavement for, you know? And the very first time we take the stage, we're playing to a mass exodus of Sinead O'Connor fans, their backs as they walk towards various other parts of the festival. And it blew our minds. You know, we didn't think we were popular, but we didn't think anything that bad was going to happen. And I remember being up there with Noel like 15 minutes before we started going, God, I can't believe how popular Sinead O'Connor is. I had no idea. And it's because we were completely out of our element and she was in hers.
So, I mean, we all think it was a good thing to do, except for West Virginia. Now that, you'll see, that was what a rough show that was.
Basically what happened, it was an incredibly hot day and they started hosing down the crowd, so it turned, you know, 40, 50 yards in front of the stage into a huge mud pit, and then this band Pavement takes the stage that 20% of the crowd's heard of, maybe, and they're like, you know, to hell with these guys. You know, the spot we're in, I think a lot of bands would have gotten covered in mud, but there's obviously no doubt that it was gonna happen.
You just sort of had some, you know, lunkheads kind of like throwing stuff at this band who weren't, you know, playing instantly recognizable sort of mosh riffs. Yeah, they got nailed a couple of times. But it definitely wasn't something that discouraged them. I don't think Pavement weren't a kind of band that had any sort of ambition to win over a Lollapalooza audience.
When we sort of had to stop and for a while, Mark asking me for a cigarette, and I bent over, and I was kind of trying to protect my stuff. I had this little Moog Prodigy that I didn't want to get destroyed. I thought it was worth like $500. I couldn't get another one, so I was like trying to block mud from hitting my stuff and trying to like take it down. Mark asked me for a cigarette, and I bent over to get him one. And in the time that I bent over to get one and handed it to him, a huge mud cake hit him right in the mouth. So all you could see was his little mouth through this mud cake, and I handed him the cigarette anyway, and he like, you know, brushed some of the mud off and lit it up.
Totally delicious, so fucking evil, man. Let's see, it's all in the mouth of mud.
And we just started getting nailed by mud cakes, and my father, first Lollapalooza show he saw, and he's a huge Pavement fan, you know, what's going on here, what's gonna happen, just confused, you know. We kept trying to play for a few minutes, and then a rock hit Steven like in the chest, I think. And we were the misplaced band on a failing bill. So, I think that was pretty clear to everybody. You know, quite frankly, I think it can be safely said that Pavement's the band that effectively did end Lollapalooza, so anybody that disses us for our participation should be happy that we actually played a significant role in the demise of that ridiculous summer event.
This is like,
it was, you know, it was a good idea on paper, you know, really good bands, and, you know, but I think that year was probably the downfall of Lollapalooza.
We're kind of used to having not the greatest success with singles, especially for Wowie Zowie when I picked them. We were kind of still a big deal, like, on the major label scene back then, because Nirvana was still big and stuff. Now we're back to underground and still selling the same amount of records, but there was a thought maybe they're going to be this, like, Nirvana type band. But then we gave them Wowie Zowie, and I picked Rattled by the Rush and Father to a Sister of Thought, these two really mellow songs, or just slow and not
But I didn't know. I think I was smoking a lot of grass back then, and to me, they sounded like hits.
It got to a point through the early stages of the tour where we were just going up there without set lists and like jamming.
We're on stage right now, playing in front of the Tibetan flag, is the Consciously Loose live performers, Pavement.
The cotton, he was just so oblivious to all their cotton plea.
I really remember the one in San Francisco we had played in a long time. Didn't even know how to play any of the songs that we were doing. Really sort of got away with a miracle gig that first Tibetan Freedom Festival, because we played all right, didn't humiliate ourselves too badly, and we were pleased with it.
Thanks very much, all the wonderful day.
Yeah, let's hear it for Pavement. Okay, now if you will just focus your attention on the blue stage, and please welcome
Yoko Ono.
But if I try to compare the songs from the new album with from the first one that you've done, Croc Grain, so I think they're more complex, but in one way you rock. Mm-hmm. There are some songs like Stereo or like Embassy Row, which is really rock, and some of the critics and some of the fans say that you will try to save rock and roll. Can you agree with that?
Yeah, right.
We already have.
Well, yeah, I think we're kind of alone on an island right now. There's some bands that are continuing on with us, Built to Spill, Sonic Youth.
Right.
You know, it's a hard burden, but we'll save it.
After that, you know, I think we opened up to say, you know, we like REM and classic rock too, and we thought, oh, if people like this, you know, like, oh, there's actually an opportunity that more people could like it. Maybe we'll try to do that, because we were probably doubtful that that could ever happen coming out of the 80s and seeing what bands were popular, and also the failure of bands in the mainstream, Husker Du and The Replacements. And
Lombardi, we love him.
Big, but we knew it was going to be a little bit bigger, and that was really always the great thing about Pavement from Demolition Plot and the first 7-inch on. There was always a really gradual progression that made sense to all of us and was really encouraging, you know, because the Nirvana thing had happened, and because that was like the time when, you know, most eligible to be signed band stuff was floating around, and none of that really hit me too much because I just didn't really deal with the business. I just dealt with things that were real, like what are we gonna do and like when are we gonna do it. I just knew at the same time, with the level of professionalism and the approach and the whole way that we did things and the reluctance to like get together and take things more seriously, that we were never going to go to a place that Nirvana went to or a lot of bigger bands. So I always assumed that it was really silly that major label people and other factors were trying to take our band seriously, because I knew the songs weren't ever going to be huge radio hits, and I just knew that we weren't going to be able to follow through.
Terra Twilight is the fourth album, and the first with a 24-track studio, the first with producer Nigel Godrich, who did Radiohead's OK Computer. What do you think he brought to it? What difference did he make?
He's a fan of the band. He doesn't want to be the guy who screws up Pavement, who comes in as producer and, like, screws up the band. We don't want to be the band that, like, sells out and sounds worse and, like, is reaching for something they're not by grabbing this well-known producer.
It's now 10 years of Pavement. Did you think when you're doing Demolition Plot and Summer Babe and stuff that 10 years later you'd be still kind of touring the world and recording records?
We're very satisfied with our level of success and all that, and amount of positive energy we get from fans and our friends for what we're doing.
I'm sick of you.
You're gonna tear him up.
No, I'm not gonna tear him up. I'm sick of you always being out of tune, late for practice, and, you know, you don't deserve to be in this group anymore, so.
Hey, that's not me. I'm over here.
Oh, sorry.
I've done a little bit of singing on the records, but this one I do a little bit more. I sing on Carrot Rope. I still haven't figured out how to play and sing at the same time, so. I tried really hard at my house the last couple of weeks, but I can't do them both at the same time.
That's when you'll do that. Well, in the past week, Pavement, welcome to Louisville, Kentucky, by the way. We've been relaxing, one would say. It's not very relaxing because this is the whole world converges in a square mile that's about 50 yards from the house that we're staying at. So we've been essentially hibernating in this house. Watching drunk America on parade. We've survived that, and we're here in this room working out our songs because they have to be worked out for this tour, essentially. So things are calming down, the hordes have left, and we're still here. We're in the aftermath picking up the trash and sorting out our songs, so.
And Bob came up with a good explanation of what Terra Twilight means.
I forgot what it was.
It's that part of dusk, right? That 10 to 15 minute period right before it gets dark, where you get a nervous chill just from like the sun going away, and you feel magical. It can be violent at times when you can't, it's the worst time to drive, once before you put your headlights on, and you can't see the other cars on the road, so it's actually the time you're supposed to be most concerned about driving.
Good. That's really good.
We've had a difficult time for the first time choosing the title of this album, because the handful that we came up with were, I thought in particular, were really bad, and very rarely do I ever like step into the fray from my little Kentucky home and get involved in these type of decisions. But I'd heard, you know, like usually when we're recording, the titles be like right in the corner as we had the title before we really even started. And the titles that they had, one of them was Farewell Horizontal.
That's what it was going to be, because I was letting Mark do the cover art and he wanted to...
Egg Recordy was one of them that they were tossing around. There's a list of like 10, and I was just like, you know...
They're all bad.
I don't know about this. I don't know if I can like spend the whole year with a tour badge on that says Farewell Horizontal Tour, you know? Play a decent fucking rock show, having no who the hell knows. But it was fun.
You were so cute.
I went west to go look for Scott, and then I realized
Hell, just send it all to my address.
Maybe get a whole, like, 5 envelopes of German shit one day and just be like, Scott, this German shit came. Which I've seen before, but it's been a few years since I quit tormenting because I got fired because they called me Harsh Harold. It's my nickname. But I was collecting their cash every night, carrying around in a duffel bag. Every night, every night I go on stage, it's like $18,323 worth of cash and put it under my floor tom, and it was from like the last 7 gigs. And sit down and like keep my eye like on the bag of cash because it was everybody's cash. And, like, you could just pay everything out of the cash bag.
Yeah.
I miss those days in a way. I'd like to quit the band and TM cash. Just do cash TMing.
Yeah, that would be great.
It's only a fiver. £5 a pair. Fuck off, mate. Don't give us
£5. No.
Fuck it.
Look at this.
What the hell is that?
That's like a promo CD. What's that thing? Yours is a wife's match.
I got more in the house, but I can't bring everything.
Hey, Drag City. It's a lot. Good job.
Yeah?
But that's worth the most.
I know, but you want it back,
don't
you?
No, you can have it.
What is that?
Oh my god.
You sold that? No, she found it. I left it at that studio.
I didn't find it. Someone found it for me.
Boris.
Oh.
No, just this person I know. Oh my god. And I have to give him lots
this
of money.
This was trying to do folk. You were a glint in someone's eye before that emote and then a sty.
Well, thank god it wasn't.
That's what it was going to be all about, just birth.
Alright.
Have no... This doesn't look like my writing. This is someone else. That was me, then came a push, but this is someone at Have No See by the man to his own erotic hands. I bet it's fucking Bingham. Probably Bingham.
Oh, yeah.
This was like Captain Beefheart's or something. It'd be worth a lot.
Don't
I'll give you a tenner.
Don't underestimate your eBay value, friend.
But I think Pavement have really sort of, I mean, they completely made their mark, you know, as one of the more influential bands. I mean, it was really funny when Pavement really became very listened to, that hearing bands employ sort of Pavementisms in their music, because it would be very obvious, because it is such a distinct sort of thing, and they were difficult in that way, which made them that much more strong and special. I mean, not unlike a band like Nirvana, which was like everybody would have loved to have been, but that in a way that was a sign of their greatness.
If you read your own press and stuff, I guess the legacy of Pavement is like this, you know, the greatest indie rock band or whatever, but we never really bought into that, you know. We never thought that we were lo-fi or indie rock or anything. You know, we still do, you know, we still think like we're a rock band, and I think we've put out some pretty good records, and I mean, they're definitely important to us.
Pavement, this concert was so much better than Deftones concert.
Gary.
Thanks. You guys stop because of the time limit.
It was fun, you know. The way I look back on that kind of thing now is that it's just any time that you were good and you felt like you were good and delivered and were part of a good show, that, you know, for an hour and 20 minutes that people who love your band came to see, and that was good. So you just wanted to do that every night. But at the end of the day, the most important thing to me was giving the same thing to these people that came to see our band that my favorite bands had given me 10, 15 years before. And that was a good, memorable performance where they got to see like songs that they really liked, played in an interesting manner live, and it was something that they talked about and got excited about. It was fun.
We're in detail the act. Don't even follow our set list.
Just so always back. Tune up.